Hi. Welcome to Brandon Lee Peck's Celebration of Life. My name is Terry Peck, and I'm Brandon's uncle. And we're grateful, the family's grateful for y'all to be here. The family extends their deepest gratitude for the outpouring of love you've shown to them through this time and for being here today. Now, Brandon's tribute is not the final word that we speak about, far from it. It's just the beginning. Because every time something reminds us of him, we will remember, smile, laugh, and share the light and life that he was to us. Let's bow our head in prayer. Father, thank you for giving us Brandon, for his life, and for the sheer joy of his presence that he gave us. Lord, be with Cadence, his mother Aunt, his sister Jessica, his brother Anthony, his grand, the love of his life, Tracy, all of his aunts, uncles, nieces, nephews, and many cousins and friends that adore Brandon. And today, we come together to honor the man we laughed and loved with throughout his life journey. And Lord, let your presence be felt today and in the months to come, especially through the hardest parts. We give you all the praise. In Jesus' name, everybody said. I'm going to hear a song from Brandon's playlist. And it's called Just Breathe.
Everything you give, did I say?
Brandon Peck, July 18, 1986 to July 4, 2023. Brandon was born in Wichita, Kansas on July 18, 1986, the son of Troy Lee and Anne Marie Peck. He moved to Maine when he was young. He lived in Old Orchard Beach in Sanford. He graduated from Old Orchard Beach High School and was currently taking college courses. Brandon could pick up and master almost anything he put his mind to. He was a jack of all trades and a hard worker. Most recently, he was employed at Pratt & Whitney, where they produce jet engine parts. He was also working towards his welding certification and was already actively working and started his own welding business. His end goal was to become an underwater welder. His interest in welding was inspired by his father, Troy, who was also an avid and highly skilled welder. Brandon enjoyed many outdoors activities. This included kayaking, photography, and especially fishing. His happy place was being on the lake, fishing pole in hand, sun on his face. He also liked to play pool with his brother, Cadence, and his friends. Brandon had an amazing sense of humor and could put a smile on anyone he encountered. Brandon's daughter, Cadence, was the focus of his life and his reason for bettering himself. He was such an amazing dad. Brandon and Cadence were glued to the hip and did everything together. They were always on adventures, going for motorcycle rides, fishing, just being together. And it didn't matter what the day consisted of, they were just happy to spend time together. She was his world and he was hers. He is survived by his daughter, Cadence Peck, his mother, Anne Marie Peck, Homosa, Florida, if I butchered that, I'm so sorry. Brandon was predeceased by his father, Troy, in 1987, and his paternal grandparents, Lauren and Ramona Peck of Neodesha, Kansas. He is also survived by his brother, Anthony Langella of Old Orchard Beach, his sister, Jessica Pettengill of Port St. Lucie, Florida, his grandmother, Millie Mishaw of Lebanon, as well as several aunts, uncles, cousins, nieces, and nephews in Maine, Kansas, and Hawaii. Brandon Lee Peck, a kind, selfless man who was a kid at heart. Better said, he was a kid trapped in a man's body. But a loving and hardworking man. As we reflect on his life today, we remember the outdoorsman, the skilled tradesman, the talented musician, the passionate photographer, a trusted friend, a loving son, brother, and grandson, and more importantly, a loving father and best friend to his beautiful daughter, Cadence. Thank you for letting me play his guitar. And of course, Brandon, it only has 5 strings on it. But he did all of this hard work. Isn't that beautiful? Just extraordinary. So I wrote this for Brandon. And yeah. Fly. We won't forget your presence and the smile that would charm the moon. We laughed and cried the stories that defined the life we knew. We know you had to leave us to go to a better place. We just wish that we could be there now. See the look upon your face, 'cause you're singing with the angels now and dancing in the sun. Walking through the streets of gold to the shouts of welcome home. I see you fishing on those peaceful shores, casting out your line. Brandon, you are free to chase the light. Spread your wings and fly. Yeah. You had your share of struggles, even hell thought you were through. But the devil wasn't ready for a street tough kid like you. You kept your faith and chin up, knowing you were not alone. For God was right there with you till the day he took you home. And you're singing with the angels now and dancing in the sun. Walking through the streets of gold to the shouts of welcome home. And I see you fishing on those peaceful shores, casting out your line. Oh, Brandon, you are free to chase the light. So spread your wings and fly. You'd be so proud of Cadence and the strength that she has shown. It's the stream. You're walking right beside her. She'll never be alone. Yeah. I told everybody that if something weird and awkward didn't happen today, it wouldn't be right. You're singing with the angels now and dancing in the sun. Walking through the streets of gold to the shouts of welcome home. And I see a fishing buddy on those peaceful shores, casting out your line. Oh, Brandon, you are free to chase the light. So spread your wings, spread your wings, spread your wings and fly. Yeah. Spread your wings and fly. Thank you, Brandon. Thank you, Brandon. The beginning. It all began in the summer of 1986 in the tiny farming town of Neodesha, Kansas, just a few hundred people less than Springvale. His mother, Ann, was only 5 months pregnant when Brandon became impatient and ready to exit the womb. Yeah. Graham, you were there.
Yes.
After three, she said yes. After three separate trips to ER, Brandon's early exit plan was denied. Temporarily, until Ann went into labor again and Brandon had her airlifted to Wichita. On the way from the hospital to the helicopter pad comes 90-pound Ann, if you even weighed that soaking wet. He was in severe pain, and meanwhile, Brandon's dad, Troy, was snapping pictures of Ann on her way out to the helicopter while getting into the helicopter.
Your dad did that.
Yeah.
Dad.
Oh, my dad? Oh, well, that may be in the preemptive passion that led to Brandon's talk, but that's not the time or place. So as my dad was taking the unflattering pictures of the van, the whole fiasco was in complete control of a little baby. Imagine that, a little unborn baby in complete control of every doctor, nurse, pilot, and parent. Needless to say, the battle between mom and baby, the baby won, and all 5 pounds, 5 ounces of Brandon Lee Peck entered the world in his 8 month. And he had actually dropped down to about 4 pounds and 14 ounces at one point. He was a preemie. You wouldn't know that by looking at him. Brandon was so tiny when he came home, his dad Troy wanted to nickname him the refrigerator. Not because of his appetite, but because Brandon was so tiny, and Troy was hoping for him to become like Refrigerator Perry. Yeah, you'll laugh because you know exactly who that is. And for those of you who don't know who he is, Refrigerator Perry was a 6'2", 335-pound defensive lineman for the Chicago Bears. And those who were Patriot fans that remembered Super Bowl 20, yeah, you're nodding your head. Yeah, Chicago Bears took this big defensive lineman and gave him the football, and he plowed through the Patriots' defense and scored a touchdown. And so Troy was being hopeful. And it's a good thing that Ann said no. He is my Boo Bear. Or, so you all that know him by Boo, you would call him the fridge or something like that. So thank you, man. He's Boo to us. The outdoorsman. Like his father, Brandon was one with nature and a true outdoorsman. Nature's where he belonged, and nature belonged in Brandon. It was his place of peace. Fishing was Brandon's favorite outdoor activity, if you didn't know that. If you were even remotely close to Brandon, you either fished with him or were on the receiving end of his never-ending stories. He was always pursuing the tank. That's the big fish, right, Anthony?
That's right.
Yeah, especially the striper. He bought his girlfriend Tracy a pink reel, a pink tackle box, and all the necessary gear to start. That's translated as, I love you, let's go fishing. And just a note, Brandon had also bought her a pink kayak. We know what color you'd like. Wait a woman's heart. One time, Anthony and Brandon were fishing, and Anthony had lifted one of his mom's cigarettes, and he was smoking it. He did that a few times. Mind you, they were, what, like 10?
Yeah.
Brandon wanted to try it. But Anthony knew it was wrong and didn't want him to do it. But Brandon persisted. So Anthony told him that if he ate half a worm, he would let him try it. And after much miserable deliberation, Brandon agreed to the contract and ate half a worm. Ew, exactly. So Anthony handed them a cigarette, and before Brandon could put it in his mouth, it dropped in the water. All that for nothing. Like his dad, Brandon cared about the intricate details of fishing. He knew the right pole, the reel, test line, and bait for each type of fish. And he even learned to make his own lures. In 2020, Brandon's grandpa Lauren, who was on his dad's side, sent Brandon his father's fishing reels. Could have thought he won the lottery. Brandon messaged me and he said he just sat in the car when he opened the box and cried because he realized those reels were in his father's hands 33 years prior. Now, being an outdoorsman comes with its host of injuries, and Brandon had his share of hooks in the hand. Brandon once managed to embed a piece of wood through his hand that required surgery. He also stepped on a piece of wood that went in an inch into his foot, and then when he, as trying to be the doctor, you remember that? Yeah. He tried to pull it out, and it snapped in half, and he landed him back in the ER once again. Another time, he cut his hand, received several stitches, and a few days later, he ripped it open, tripping on the stairs, and again, landed himself back in the ER. Brandon, nature, injuries. I just went with the territory. His love for nature and animals. Brandon messaged me one day about his brother. He said, Anthony's making fun of me because every fish I catch, I give it a kiss, and then I spend a minute reviving it, running water through its gills before I let it swim off to be sure it has enough oxygen and energy. He continued his message by saying, knowing my dad had the same passion for the outdoors and animals, it made me wonder if that's what I do. And his dad did love animals. They had a little farm, and they had a turkey named Gobble Girl and a goat named Bogart. It's a menagerie of pets. 10 days later, Brandon messaged me again. He said he was going to go out and catch some stripers, and he ended the message with, Uncle Terry, I talked to Dad this morning to wish him Happy Father's Day, and please help me catch a big tank. Now, back to his love for animals. Brandon loved Tracy's cats and spoiled them rotten. Bought him a tower, treats, and toys. Tracy said it was so cute in the shell. Everybody agreed. Once when Brandon was cutting a tree down, he saw a nest of baby squirrels. He gently relocated them because he was worried their mother would not be able to find them. He said, after a few minutes of hearing their little cries, these are his words, I saw the mother return to find them. And of course, he snapped the picture to document the event. They're still on Facebook today. Brandon's grand said that Brandon felt terrible about her cat Rosie passing away and offered to give her an appropriate burial in the backyard. If you're laughing, you know what's coming next. Brandon dutifully began digging the grave and abruptly ran into the house, hollering. When Graham asked him what was happening, Brandon said he dug down and hit some bones and wanted to know who was buried in the backyard. He was serious. But come to find out, it was Graham's other cat, Boots, that her late husband, Ray, had buried years earlier. And I can tell you that Rosie and Boots are blissfully buried together. Thank you, Brandon. That's so Brandon. Spiders. Yeah, he loved God's creatures, but that was not one of them. Brandon's greatest fear was spiders. When Brittany and Brandon lived in his sister Jessica's basement, there were giant wolf spiders. And got a confirmation and an amen there. And Brandon would always throw shoes at them, and Brittany would look at him dumbfounded and say, "What are you doing? Wouldn't you rather find it and kill it and make it knocked down than for it to get lost?" And despite her reasonable logic, Brandon continued to launch his spear at his foe. Graham said that if he saw a spider, he would make her kill it. Tracy said they were camping in a tent with spiders on top, and he screamed and he said, "You gotta kill it! You gotta kill him for me!" And Tracy said, "It's just a little spider, but I'll kill it for you." And when Kate said, "It was so great to see Kate's," she laughed and said that one time her dad saw a spider on the floor and he screamed like a little girl, jumped up and yelled, "Kill it! Kill it!" And even after he was dead, he was still scared. He said, "Pick it up, throw it away." And you heard it right, folks. The guy who could hook worms, eat worms, and kiss fish had his teenage daughter kill and dispose of a spider. The creative prodigy. Brandon was right brain dominant. If you're a left brain dominant, you're analytical and methodical. But a right brain dominant person is associated with creativity, emotion, and intuition. See some nodding of the heads. This artistic side of the brain, that was Brandon. So we'll dive into some of his creative efforts. And the first one was photography. I won't forget the day I saw a post of Brandon with an expensive camera, holding it up, his selfie, and announced his passion for photography. And I remember thinking, okay, here we go. This is passion number 10,392. And what I mean is that Brandon would have so many things going on at the same time, so many projects and so many goals, and he would often get overwhelmed. And his grand would say, "Brandon, just take it one thing at a time." But Brandon embraced life. And if something excited him, there was no reins to pull him back in. And like everything else, he wasn't just a jack of all trades, he mastered a lot. Photography was just one. And he learned everything about that camera and how to take great pictures. And his grandma called him lying sprawled out on the front lawn, taking pictures of bugs. And she kept going back to the window, and he was still out there laying, sprawling out, sprawled out on the ground taking pictures of insects. But they were good pictures. Yeah. You know, there's four other professional photographers in his family. I think that's by coincidence. The musician. You all know that Brandon was an incredible musician. When he was little, Ann tried different types of instruments to get him interested, get him focused. And one day, Boo had a friend who had taken piano lessons for 8 years, and he borrowed his little portable keyboard and brought it home. He said, "Mom, listen to this." It was Beethoven's Furies. He had learned it in 10 days. Then he learned Swans on the Lake in just a matter of days. He found his niche. Another passion. His childhood friend, Rihanna, had posted what a fantastic piano player he was. Because when he was 14, the little heartbreaker asked her on a date that included candles, a finely prepared meal with mac and cheese. Yeah. And he proceeded to serenade her with Casey and JoJo's "All My Life" on song and piano. Then he picks up guitar, and he mastered it. And the first time I heard him was in 2017, and he was finger-picking a song called "More Than Words" by Extreme. That's hard to play. I owned a studio. I heard lots of musicians. He was good. So he mastered that. He was incredible. I couldn't believe it. And Anthony told me that him and Brandon wrote a lot of songs together, and they would get together and have their jam sessions recording and goofing and writing. Brandon being the guitar player and Anthony being the lyricist. Now, Now, when it came to singing, which he did a lot of in the shower, well, let's just say that he was really good at piano and really good at guitar, and we'll just leave it at that. Welding. Brandon worked 3 12-hour shifts at Pratt & Whitney and was attending welding 2 days a week until his passing. And Brandon possessed a special talent for welding, a craft that ran deep in his family's blood. He started welding, just like his dad. His dedication and craftsmanship was evident in every piece he created, each one a testament to his meticulous nature and an unwavering passion for excellence. That was Brandon. In my last exchange with Boo was April 13th of this year. He had posted videos of his welding, and I couldn't believe what I saw this beautiful bead. And I said, man, look at you. It's exceptional. He said, thanks, man. I think about my dad during the process. Like when I bought this new welder, I just wondered what he thought about these new machines because they produce such a beautiful, stable arc. Cooking. When it came to cooking, Brandon and Jessica could spend hours talking about food, and Tracy said he would cook for her and clean the kitchen. Tracy and her mother, Michelle, recalled the first time he came over to meet the family, and there was a lot of people, like 12. Can you imagine a young man just going into the family the first time, it's the whole house full of people. And at least a dozen. And Brandon not only cooked an intricate burrito meal, not just your standard burrito, these were intricate burritos, but he also cleaned up the kitchen and impressed everyone. Great first impression. Her mother was impressed. Michelle. At Tracy and Brandon's engagement party, they had a cake that had her name on it. And nobody was eating the cake. Michelle said that he looked over and he said, I'm eating that bleep cake because it's got my name on it. Anthony and Brandon would have a thing, a cook-off called a steak-off. And they'd go out and they'd buy like the real expensive steaks. He'd come back. And Brandon had his own garlic butter. And there was no declared winner. But you did a lot of that. And that's awesome. Ann said that the first time when Brittany and Brandon had got together, Brandon cooked them she remembered the meal, I don't even remember what I made for breakfast yesterday. Brandon cooked for them a bacon wrap full egg with garlic asparagus, baked potato with salads, and lit candles. It was delicious. Boo's love for family and friends. Show me your friends, I'll show you your future. Brandon Peck, June 15th, 2023, just 20 days before his entrance to heaven. Brandon deeply cared about his friends and family. He had a huge heart, and he loved hard with it. If something wasn't right with family or friends, Brandon would worry about them. He'd do everything he could to make it better, make their situation better. He did it unselfishly. And more importantly, he wanted just to make them feel better. He was kind and generous and loving and forgiving and everything that is right in this world. It was felt. His love was felt. His friend Brandon again posted how much Brandon cherished his entire family. It's everybody spread out. Florida, Kansas, Maine, Hawaii. His mom, grandbrother, sister, cousins, everybody. Brandon could be having the absolute worst day of his life, but you would never know it because he was more concerned about you. He wanted to make your day better. Brandon Lee Peck was the expressed example of love, God's love. And John 15:13 says, greater love has no one than this to lay down his life for his friend. That was Brandon. The no left behind love. And you knew that when he talked to you because his eyes would light up and his voice would go up another pitch. Brandon's friend, Trisha, noted that he knows how to make you feel better when days were rough. She said that his soul was old and his spirit was bright. I like that. She said that he was a great friend and a rock to many when they were younger. His friend Cody noted We used to call each other brother, and our daughters called all of us uncle. His friend Alan said, "I'll never forget our long talks about life and its struggles and what true friendship should feel like. You are a true friend all the way around and a wonderful human being." Brandon's friend Alan Main shared how he and Brandon hit it off on a fishing page on social media, so he was just looking for someone to go fishing with. Someone to join him in the morning of fishing, and when they met, Alan shared something that was very unique about Brandon. It was his handshake. It was different. It wasn't like anyone else's. It just made you feel welcome. You know you have a fishing buddy when you both get excited about talking about swim bait for an hour. And he could. Brandon lived with his grand for the last 5 years, along with Cadence every other week, and he loved to take care of her. He liked ordering food and having it delivered to grand. And she would tell him, "No, no, no, it's too expensive." And he would get so mad, the Irish would come out in him. She said he was just trying to take care of me, so on occasion I would say yes. Graham said that even though Brandon was a grandson, he felt more like a son to her, the way he treated her. And Graham said that Brandon was always doing things for her, fixing things around the house. And if he got stuck on something, he would just call Uncle Steve and they would get it figured out. Tracy was the love of his life. She said he treated her like a queen. Doted on her. And I heard that from her mother too, and that's a hard thing to impress sometimes is your own mother. Her mother, Ms. Michelle, said she loved him for being a gentleman. Or loved Brandon for being a gentleman to her daughter and treating her son so well. It was mutual as Tracy accepted and loved Cadence. Tracy would always tell Brandon how proud she was of him and affirmed his worth, and Brandon needed that. She respected that Brandon put Cadence first in his life. Tracy said that if they had any problems between them in the relationship, and she shared those issues honestly, Brandon immediately worked on it and fixed it, and that was that. He owned up to it. Tracy and Brandon gave each other unconditional love, and that just wasn't normal. All right, the prankster and the joker. And then there was Brandon's Henri grin. You know that big, goofy smile he had? His father had that same Cheshire Cat grin. And the Cheshire Cat, if you remember, was a fictional character in Alice's Adventure in Wonderland. That was Brandon. You never knew what he was getting ready to say or do. Katie and Brandon were always making jokes and creating pranks on each other. After all, they were best friends. Cadence and Brittany said that if you're in the middle of a conversation, Brandon would randomly interrupt you with a sound, and they laughed. She said, like, he would do that, like, in the most inappropriate time, a time that people just would not do that. Cadence said he responded that every time she exposed him for something or called him out on something, some truth. And Cadence had this firm rule about him not tracking dirt into her room, which he did 50% of the time. Would that be a fair assessment? And she would call him on it. As soon as she called him on it, he'd go, Brandon, so Brandon. Cadence said that Cadence Brittany said that Brandon would often speak in movie lines. And there was this one French word that he would say, Disco la chevie. What is it? Okay, well, either Brandon probably may not have said it. Well, I looked it up and I couldn't find out what it meant. You know, so
means I'm a little girl.
You're a little girl? Yeah. Okay, well,
it's from an old commercial.
Oh, it's an old commercial? Okay. Well, I was going to say, if you know French and that's not it and it's something inappropriate, just laugh to yourself and don't say anything. But he said it all the time. Thank you. One day, Brandon asked Cadence to get him a small glass of milk. And she did. She went and found the smallest, tiniest little vessel in the kitchen. He brought it in here. Of course, he took a picture of it. He thought that was so funny. All right. One time, Katie's, her mom, Britt, and Sandy were camping. And Katie's came in with an empty Corona bottle, washed it out, and put apple juice in it. Brittany and Sandy said, "Oh, you should send that to your dad." So Katie sent a short video to her dad of her drinking the apple juice right out of the Corona bottle. Of course, it didn't know the difference. Followed by a short text from Cadence that read, "Oops, wrong person." You remember that. Brandon, meanwhile, is on a romantic trip with Tracy. They're out fishing. And you know, he got so mad. And he called Cadence and said, "Cadence, what are you doing? Where are you at?" And Cadence replied just calmly, "Why does it matter?" Just poked a bear. Brandon said, "What are you doing? Where's your mom? I'm coming there." And put up all his fishing poles. And Brittany and Sandy were just in tears at this point. And you know, as he started to put everything away, then the jig was up. They told him what was going on, spilled the beans on the prank. And then Brandon had that little nervous laugh like his dad. He's like, "Good one. You guys got me good." Brandon and Cadence also played too many jokes on Graham for her to even remember them all. But it was constant, and it was wonderful. The family said that one of the things that made the family laugh is how Brandon answered the phone when you called him. Hello? Hello. Hello. That was wonderful. Anthony and Brandon would speak to each other in movie lines and often call each other up saying the most ridiculous things, like one would call the other one up and say, "Hey, I got chickens for sale." And one time, Anthony called Brandon and announced himself as a Sanford police officer. And then he arrested Anthony and was going to take him to jail, and Brandon freaked out and was scared, saying, "What happened? What's going on? What did he do?" And the officer replied, "Prostitution." Of course, Anthony just broke out in laughter, and again, the jig was up. He got him. He prayed. Now, this is random, but once Brandon wrapped a coworker's car in saran wrap. That was just. You guys see that picture where he posted that? That was hilarious. Ann said that one night when the kids were young adults, and I just love this story, they went to the pier in Old Orchard to watch a hypnotist. The hypnotist called them up on the stage, called them, and attempted to hypnotize them. Ann pretended but couldn't hold back the laughter, so she had to get up and sit down. The hypnotist kicked Anthony off because he couldn't hypnotize him. So Brandon's next. And the hypnotist starts his hypnotizing routine. Suddenly, the hypnotist told Brandon, "You're a chicken." Brandon starts clucking. And his head starts jerking, and his hands start folding back like a wing, and he's sitting in the chair, and he's kicking and he's clucking so loudly, and everybody is rolling. And afterwards, you know, when he came out of hypnotism, he came back, sat down, and
we were still laughing at him. He had no idea.
He had no clue.
No, but everybody was looking at him like.
And they told him, "You're hypnotized." And he wouldn't believe him. He really. So he was actually hypnotized, and that just made the story just that much more funny. So he was absolutely convinced it did not happen.
He had his feet kicking.
Anthony recalls when he and Brandon would push their beds together and make this giant mat, a wrestling mat. And the goal was to knock the other one through the middle. Yeah. And one time, Ann was leaving and told him to stop or someone was going to go through the second floor window. And when she returned, the second floor window was broken and Anthony was vaulted out. Dan recalled a time when she took Brandon to the social club, and there were people dressed up really nice, big floppy hats.
Kentucky Derby,
okay. And Brandon took the hat off of somebody and actually walked around and wore it for the rest of the time. Ann said that Brandon had an unusual and awesome side effect when he drank beer. the face turned red.
Drink anything. Just like his father.
Yeah.
Right to that.
So if he drank beer, his face was red, and she said, "Have you been drinking?" Well, it's automatic detection. Finally, Cadence. Cadence was his number one and most important person in his life and devoted herself to being the best father. And everyone knew it. Cadence said, "My dad was my best friend. They did everything together, as you heard in the obituary. And they loved to play pool." As Cadence's mother, Brittany, said, those two were two peas in a pod, glued to the hip. And Brittany resigned the fact that Brandon was the cool parent. Kate said, when her friends would come over, they said, "Your dad is so cool." And I believe it. Kate says, Brandon's legacy and his personality will live through and continue to touch lives. Kate was his pride and joy and the embodiment of everything he held dear. And sweetheart, your dad's life was a song and you were the Kate's. You're the rhythm that just keeps going and going. And something else I just want to share that I just felt was incredible was the relationship that Brandon had with Brittany. John, it's rare when you have two parents that have a child and those parents aren't together, and how well they got along and they were there for each other and they planned together. And it was beautiful. And lastly, Brandon was a believer and his selfless love demonstrated that. He loved Cadence with everything in him, his family, his friends, and he loved life. He knew God was the author of that love. And we had many conversations about that love, and especially how the hardest person to love is yourself, and that was really hard for Brandon sometimes. Sometimes he struggled with that, but I think we all do at times. But Brandon would reach out when he struggled, and I would just listen, and we pray. And I would remind him that God will generously give you the strength beyond your own to get you through the storm. And I shared with him our Peck family motto, and that's Pecks don't quit, not let simply means it's faith in God, love for family. And your ability to pick yourself up and carry yourself through. You know, with family, God, and taking that self-determination, you can get through anything because everything's going to be okay. If Brandon made a terrible choice in life, he would fully own up to it, and we heard that. That's integrity, and we're all imperfect people. And when we take personal accountability for our mistakes, it orients our life toward the truth. And that truth leads to freedom, and freedom from the darkest areas of our life that we continually run from. And John 8:32 says, "Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." Brandon was no stranger to the rain, but as life would get hard, Brandon would love his way through that. He'd work his way through it in truth and love. And yeah, he would love his way out of the storm by loving us, serving us, unselfishly making us feel better about our mess. Brandon had perseverance. Brittany has shared that over and over again. Tracy has shared that over and over again. And just one of Brandon's posts was, one of his last posts was, "I will never stop growing, learning, and adapting to become the best human I can be." Brandon Lee Peck, the guitar picker, the chef, the pianist, the fisherman, the skilled welder, the photographer, the prankster, the giver, the teacher, the hugger, the encourager, the loyal brother, son, and friend, and an amazing, fun, devoted dad. What more than a friend could you ask for? There's a video of Brandon playing a Michael Franti song on the guitar called "Hey World." And Brandon beautifully sings the line, "Don't give up on me, and I won't give up on you." And his sister Jessica wanted me to read this, and then Brittany will get up, and then Cadence. This is from his sister Jessica. "Brandon was incredible at playing the piano. I remember the first time he ever played on his keyboard over the phone, and he called me so excited and wanted to show me his talent. And I'll never forget him playing it for the first time, and I laughed because I said, 'That is definitely not you. This is one of your pre-recorded settings on your keyboard.' And he quickly convinced me that it was him, and I knew it because he had made a mistake." He was incredible, and I remember sitting with such admiration of his talent and couldn't believe it. I remember telling him to never give up that talent and to not keep growing and learning. I remember telling my mom to do whatever it took to invest in that talent. And Ann had already done so much legwork, but he found the talent. And the most miraculous thing about it was he couldn't read music at all. He learned by simply hearing it and playing it, a natural savant of music. Brandon also loved to take things apart and try to put them back together. And I remember him taking apart our Nintendo, and anytime Mom would clock in anything as far as toys and radios at some point, he would find it in pieces, but he was able to put it back together. He was great at everything he did, and if he found something he couldn't perfect, he would keep doing it until he did. He was an amazing father, an old soul at such a young age, what I best describe as a rare find. He put his heart in everything and everyone he knew. Every one of us will take a special part of Brandon with him and with them and keep his memory alive. Look at all of us. Look at this love in this room. Look at how lucky we are to have been a part of this life. I miss our talks every day. Talks about photography, politics, growing old, and falling apart. I miss our inside jokes. Anthony and Brandon share. Brandon share. We're talking about our future, helping with business and giving advice. We talk a lot about our passion for photography, and I miss his calls. Even when he just set the phone down and put me on mute, and I would just ramble. I'm glad God brought us together one last time this month. We got to laugh, joke, hug, watch the fireworks, and argue. I told everyone I got full sibling experience the last time. I'm thankful for that. I want every one of you to think of Brandon on July 4th when you're seeing all the beautiful colors in the sky. Please light one for him and speak of your favorite memories of him. Keep his memory alive.
Of a bad boy. We got into a lot of mischief together, went on crazy adventures. We drove my father pretty crazy and probably gave him most of his gray hair. We had so much fun together, and we went through countless ups and downs. Our relationship and Brandon himself helped shape me into the person I am today. Even our inside jokes still lived on. The infamous hurro, durka durka, when he just touched your cheek instead of your mouth, all came from a movie that we loved watching together. It was completely done with marionettes. A movie that at my age I had no business renting or watching since it was highly inappropriate. I remember sitting in the pitch black at 2 a.m. on the jetty surrounded by the sounds of the crashing waves, exhausted with him, while he hoped just to catch one single striper. We loved being spontaneous, randomly deciding to go somewhere. A trait that he still held on to today. Then came our biggest accomplishment together, our beautiful daughter, Cadence. Brandon couldn't deny that child, if he tried. I always complained I did the hard part and she came out as his carbon copy. What I didn't realize is I was also giving birth to his best friend and the air in his lung. Cadence being born made us both realize why people said having a child is like having your heartbeat on the outside of your body. She was Brandon's purpose, his driving force, and boy, was that obvious. Like I said before, they were two peas in a pod, and they understood each other like no one else did. She could tell him everything, and he did, in fact, get it when he said he did. I was so envious, yet thankful for their relationship. I love my daughter, and we're incredibly close, but I accepted and understood that their relationship was just different, and that ours, that it was different than ours and it was special. I'm so lucky that our friendship stayed as strong as ever. We talked all the time, said jokes to each other, talked about things going on in our lives, and it would sometimes just confide in each other when we wanted another opinion on something. I truly value him in every aspect as a father and a friend. I still have the urge to send him a text daily and tell him something silly Cadence has done or vent to Ben about her being a moody teenager. It hurts deep in my soul that he won't physically be here to pair it with me. To be there for milestones with Cadence. He was and is still our biggest fan. I'm so thankful I let my friends introduce us so many years ago. I'm not surprised he clicked instantly. He was just that kind of person. You couldn't help but love him. He was just so much fun and so damn funny. Brandon always had and always will have a place in my heart, and I will do my best to honor him and be there for our daughter. I'll always do my best to be more than cool Sharon, which again, definitely was him. Brandon, I love and miss you. I'm quoting a line from one of our songs together some years ago. I'll be the greatest fan of your life.
Thank you.
Cadence and his life. Father, thank you for this life, this crazy, beautiful, hard, and joyful life. Thank you for your son, Jesus. Thank you for the love you put inside Brandon and his desire to take care of us so unselfishly. Thank you for everything we have learned from him and will continue to learn from him, from his extraordinary life. We lift up sweet Cadence and ask you to be with her, to grow her and guide her in your love and all the good seeds that her parents planted within her to live the best life possible. May your angels watch over her, just like her dad is right now. Thank you for everyone here who has come to honor Brandon's life and legacy. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
We're just